I said it yesterday on the show that they did not give any press release responses, no scripted code. Because, well, there was no way you could have given me a scripted code anyway, and I'm not trying to, you know, brag. I was moderating it, so I wasn't going to... There was no way you could have given me a scripted answer. Because they didn't know what questions I was going to ask anyway.
And they said, too, I mean, there was some gasp, like, you're asking me this question, this question. There's these thoughtful pauses, and you could tell it was not...
You're right. When I started with, there was some gasp.
But that is the role that you as a journalist, it's a role and a responsibility you assumed, and it's very important to understand something. We're not even at the stage where addressing poverty is trending. It's not even close to that.
Yeah.
Our role as opinion shapers, and those of us that speak into microphones, make no mistake about it, we help shape opinion. We've got to have an agenda ourselves that raise salient issues that matter. And nothing could matter more than located here in the heart of the Midwest than poverty.
Kristen coined a word in the air saying poverphobia.
Yeah, I said poverphobic because I think that there is this fear about talking about poverty. It's the P word that nobody really wants to talk about, whether it's in the Ivy Tower or the exclusive tickets to the event with the president of a university, or whether it's here online or wherever it is, because that cannot be packaged well. I mean, it really can't.
Well, it is what it is.
That's the issue I talk about when I talk about, for example, the black community. We have the largest concentration of black folk of any major city in the country right here in America, and it's in Detroit. And the thing that gets me is that many black folks in leadership position would be suffering from this poverphobic phenomenon you talk about, because they don't want to address the issue inside of our own community and the severe class and intellectual divide that exists.
It's embarrassing.
A new word has been coined here. Christine coined a new word, poverphobia. Okay, Joseph, your second question.
Well, I got to admit, how can you miss this much poverty and then have a forum and say, tell us what's going on? How could you miss it? But another thing I look at, like she said, legacy donation.
Right.
They gave $1.5 million, one of these foundations, to Sheila Cockrell. For what? But yet on your show, 3 weeks ago, you had that pastor who's helping people, who says, look, we don't turn anybody away. We're doing houses. We're putting...
Yeah, and the Rescue Mission is...
That man can use it. Well, that's the man that needs to be at the conference and telling these foundations, we could do this and do that.
That's right.
We could build a new bridge. Okay, we can't get people out to the apprenticeships. Those foundations should be pressing these unions. Open up these apprenticeships. We'll provide transportation for Detroiters to get out there so they can get these jobs. They should be using their political clout in Lansing and get these legislators to say, listen, you've got to reduce this car insurance and stop penalizing these people so they can get to these jobs. All these sort of things they could do.
Yeah, but see, if we don't raise this as an issue, they will skateboard right by. You mentioned Sheila Cockrell. This is amazing because it's Sheila Cockrell who, when told the people without water and the water should be free, she said, go get a bucket and dip it in the Detroit River. And you give a woman like that, you give a woman, it's on tape, we could play it. It's amazing how blind some of these philanthropic organizations are, but because they've done it before, they do it again. Unless there are opinion shapers that say, whoa, wait a minute, are you aware that this is what that woman said? Whoa, wait a minute, are you aware that this is what the president of Wayne State University said? I mean, those foundations need to think twice, but they need to hear. They need to hear from true grassroots organizations about what their needs are.
I didn't get the invitation.
All right. All right, Joseph. Thank you. Thank you so much, Joseph. Christine, to what Sam said, and I think you highlighted that earlier also, the narrative, right? Linking the narrative of the people whose lives you want to change, and that to ensure that, in fact, the work that you're doing is authentic and that you're not even operating from a ball or from some sort of an ivory tower.
Exactly. If the board is able to meet individuals who are directly impacted by either they're giving a specific service or a dollar amount, and a child can say, and you can meet that child, and that child or that single mother can say, this is how now I'm able to go to a job interview more confident. I'm able to wear clothing that matches. I'm able to use the technology, the resources. I wasn't able to upload my resume because I don't have those capacities. I don't have a printer at home. I don't have Wi-Fi.
Right.
These are all disadvantages, and I think that sometimes people forget that it's not a matter of trying or a matter of effort. It is a matter of the access to resources, and doesn't necessarily have to be that way.
No question. 313-778-7600. 313-778-7600 is the number to call and chime in this conversation, my guest, Kristen Meekoff and Sam Riddle. The role of institutions in Detroit's comeback. Think about it. If in fact we have this full force, institutions using their full weight to help address the problems that we have, we could be much farther ahead. Somebody said on Facebook today, I think it was Isaiah Bomer, he said, you know, our universities, colleges have to go beyond just providing us some sort of a scenic view of how beautiful and how much of a nice architecture they have, and that they need to be engaged in the community. Yesterday, we talked about this, and I referenced this book in my column today. Judith Rodin is a former president of the University of Pennsylvania. She went on to serve as president of the Rockefeller Foundation in New York. She wrote this book, The University and Urban Revival, Out of the Ivory Tower and Into the Streets. This was the subtext, if you will, of our conversation yesterday. It drove much of our conversation. And today in the Detroit News, I referenced Judith Rodin's work in my column, Colleges Can Be Anti-Poverty Institutions. But the thing that amazes me is that it's not like we're speaking in abstract terms here. An example has been set. And so there's no excuse for any college president in this area to say, well, I don't know if that's possible or not. All I'll do is I'll recommend that you read Judith Rodin's book. And of course, you can read my column. I'm sure some of them have already read my column because I got an email from the University of Michigan today saying great column. But I hope that these universities, especially in Detroit, because Detroit's comeback, we can't leave that alone at the feet of Mike Duggan, the city council, and everybody else who's at downtown. These institutions, Sam, they carry a lot of weight. They have a lot of resource, and they have a lot of strength.
Absolutely, the academic institutions do. And also, there's plenty of precedent for this set, but it's usually by profiteers. Take, for example, the pharmaceuticals.
Right.
I was just sitting up here thinking about all the new drugs that are developed in academic institutions for profit. And then these big endowments get funded, or you get endowments as a result of working with the medical community and the pharmaceuticals who are in it for the big buck, for profit. There's no big buck except for societal savings and building a nation that we can all be proud of when you focus in on poverty. But the same energy and resources that you use that result in big buildings and laboratories being built on campuses to further, for example, pharmaceuticals, I'm just using that as an example, or the automobile industry uses in terms of the engineering components of these universities, why couldn't we do the same thing with the schools of social work, political science, architecture, and whatnot at the university? We can do that if there's a commitment. There must be a commitment, like the woman from the University of Pennsylvania had, Rodin. And if we have that commitment, she should actually be welcomed at any institution located next to a urban area like Detroit is.
Right.
Wayne State University's president could have her come in and meet with her, just like the heads of two foreign states would meet. We need to have that type of a meeting between Dr. Rodin and the head of Wayne State University.
Roy Wilson.
And if they can suffocate their ego long enough to listen.
But Roy Wilson already said just because we're in the city of Detroit doesn't mean we have to reflect the inner city.
Well, he can grow. We can all grow.
He said it's redemption, no question.
I think awareness and leaving the ego and understanding that we all have blind spots.
That is true.
We all have blind spots, and being willing to be vulnerable and say, what is it that I can learn? I made a statement. This was not reflective. Perhaps it was, perhaps it wasn't, of what I want our community to go forward in.
Right.
And this is what I'm willing to do to change.
Right.
Please help me see.
Yeah.
I need help.
That's going to take a lot.
That's going to take a lot of work.
It's the lens through which you see things. If you see things through the lens of compassion, if you see things through the lens of learning, but that's interesting that you, these statements like these happen from, unfortunately, situations where learning is what your business is about.
Right. Look, if he was a white male or white female heading that institution here in Detroit and made that same statement, we would be demonstrating against him, charging him, rightfully so, with furthering systemic racism from that institution, and he'd be catching pure hell.
Did you send him a copy of the film?
No, I tell you, they read it. They follow the show and they read these things religiously. So let me do this. We're going to come back to another call in a second, but take a listen to Judith Rodin. This show was speaking at the University of California, San Diego. This was a lecture about resilient cities. Take a listen to this woman, the example she set. And we've been using this to kind of, you know, really set the stage for this conversation. Take a listen.
It's really commendable that at this moment in its history, UCSD is systematically planning to help grow the urban core by investing in bridging its commitment to the innovation economy to downtown San Diego and developing a diverse talent pool that will benefit from and contribute to economic growth. Importantly, the plan, as you know, includes connecting in multiple ways with diverse neighborhoods surrounding the new projects. Neighborhoods like the Diamond District and Golden Hill, and like Barrio Logan, where if I have time, I look forward to visiting Salute Tacos and Bordeaux Brewing. I salute Chancellor Khosla and Associate Vice Chancellor Walshock for their vision, and I welcome them to the fraternity of university leaders who have seized the opportunity and the obligation to ask themselves what they could and should do for their city, and how fortunate you are to be doing it here in this engine of economic growth and innovation called California. When I took over at Penn, our situation in Philadelphia was dramatically different. The blight of the local neighborhoods had become the plight of the university. Students felt less safe, and parents felt less comfortable sending them there. Crime had soared. 1 in 5 residents lived below the poverty level. Shops and businesses had closed. Families had abandoned houses. The streets were literally filled with trash. Pedestrian traffic vanished. Middle-class families moved out, and drug dealers moved in. And Philadelphia's municipal finances were on the ropes. We knew that we could never have a future as a truly great university in a disintegrating community and an economically weakening city, even if we were foolish enough to want such a thing. We needed to become a force for strengthening our community and building its efficacy. We needed to focus on the economic vigor of Philadelphia. We needed to be a partner, and we needed others to partner with us. Penn found that, like all anchor institutions, it had a crucial role to play, but sometimes we played the preacher, and other times we stepped back into the choir. And in the process, we demonstrated just what powerful an impact a university can have when it accepts that its destiny is intertwined.